In the previous video, we have started up studying the buck converter or the buck DC regulator, and we said that the buck regulator or the buck DC converter consists of a series inductor with a parallel capacitor, and we have control switch. This control switch can be a transistor. This switch has two modes. The first mode or mode 1 when it is connected directly to the source, and mode 2 when it is connected to freewheeling diode to discharge the inductor. And we studied the voltage and the current and the different parts of this circuit of buck regulator. Now we are going to complete our study. In this video, we are going to study at the beginning the peak-to-peak inductor ripple current. We said that the current at the inductor goes from I1 to I2 in the charging mode, and goes from I2 to I1 in discharging mode, and goes periodically in this waveform. The ripple current in this case is delta I, which is I2 over minus I1. To determine the ripple current delta I, we are going to start with the results which we have obtained in the previous video, that the first time or the mode time, the time of the mode 1, the time of mode 1 or switching on mode, T1, it was delta I multiplied by L over Vs minus Va, where Vs is the voltage of the source and Va is the average voltage at the load. And T2, the switching of time, equals delta I multiplied by L over V average. And we said that the relation between the average voltage at the load and the source voltage, V source, V average equals K multiplied by V source, where K is the duty cycle of this periodic function. T1 plus T2, equals the complete periodic time T. So T equals T1 plus T2. This means that T equals delta I multiplied by L over Vs minus Va plus delta I multiplied by L over Va. And the periodic time T equals 1 over the operating frequency, 1 over F. Now, by arranging this summation, we can make the denominator as a common denominator. No, it is not required. Make the denominator as a common denominator. So it would be Vs minus Va multiplied by Va. And here we have Va, and here we have Vs minus Va. So this would be Vs multiplied by delta I multiplied by L over Va multiplied by Vs minus Va. This equals 1 over F, and we are interested in the value of delta I, which is the ripple current in the inductor or peak to peak inductor ripple current. So delta I in this case would be Va multiplied by Vs minus Va, which was the denominator here, would be the denominator in the other side, over F over L multiplied by Vs, the remaining part. So delta I, or the peak to peak ripple inductor ripple current, delta I equals the average value as the load multiplied by Vs minus Va, the voltage at the source minus the average voltage at the load, over the frequency multiplied by the inductor multiplied by Vs. We can divide both the denominator and the denominator by Vs. VA over VS equals K. VA over VS equals K. And we can take VS here as a common. So VS multiplied by 1 minus VA over VS, which is K. So delta I equals VS multiplied by the duty cycle K multiplied by 1 minus the duty cycle K over the frequency multiplied by the inductance L. This is a peak-to-peak inductor level term. On the other hand, what is a peak-to-peak voltage at the capacitor? So peak-to-peak capacitor level voltage, which is actually the peak-to-peak voltage at the output, because the voltage of the capacitor is the voltage at the output. And as I said, the output voltage here is not constant, has some ripples, but the current at the load is constant. From this node, it can be noted that the inductance current IL is divided between the capacitor and the load. So IL equals I capacitor plus I node, where I node is the current at the load. Usually, the value of the current at the load is much less than the current at the capacitor. So we can approximate this relation to be nearly delta IL nearly equal delta IC, assuming that delta I naught is very small. And this is actually because we are assuming that the output current is nearly constant. So the change in the current in the inductor will appear as a change in the current in the capacitor and will not change the current at zero. So delta I naught is very small, and as a sequence, delta IL is a change in the current, which we have already proved right now, equals delta IC, the change of the current in the capacitor. Now, let us look at the current at the capacitor. We can see that the current at the capacitor is delayed with respect to current at the inductor by a phase shift 90 degrees. It is not phase shift, it is from the center of the charging period to the center of this charging period, instead from the start to the end. So at this period, which is from T1 over 2 to T1 over 2 plus T2 over 2, which equals half the periodic time, at this time period, the capacitor is charging on, means that we are increasing the voltage of the charge. The average current at the charging period of the capacitor, it can be obtained by taking the area under the curve, which is this triangle, over the period of this triangle. So the average DC current, the average positive DC current in the charging mode in this case would be delta I over 4. How comes? Actually, it is the delta current, delta I current, delta IC, delta IC over 2 is the average, because if we are taking the average of such triangle shape, it would be the maximum value over 2. So delta IC over 2, and because we are talking about half the period, so it would be delta IC over 4, and delta IC equals delta I. So the equivalent DC current at the capacitor would be delta I over 4. Delta I over 4. This is actually because delta IC in the above the zero is half the complete delta I, and here we are moving from I1 minus IA to I2 minus IA. Here in the positive I'm just moving half delta I, and by taking the average it would be delta I over 2 over 2, so it would be delta I over 4. So this is the equivalent DC current at the capacitor. This DC current will be charging the capacitor, and we know that the voltage at the capacitor can be obtained as 1 over C by integration of the current over the capacitor dt. And assuming that we are charging the capacitor, so the final value would be the initial value plus the integration 1 over C multiplied by the integration IC delta T. Assuming that we are taking the average quantity of the current at the capacitor, so we can replace IC instead of being function of time, it would be delta I over 4 with constant time. And the periodic or the period of the charging is T over 2. So in this case, the integration IC delta T, it can be replaced by delta I over 4 multiplied by the charging period T over 2. So delta I over 4 multiplied by T over 2 could be T delta I over 8. T delta I over 8. And this quantity is divided by the value of the capacitance C. And assuming that by taking the initial voltage at the left side, so the new capacitor voltage minus the old capacitor voltage, which is delta VC, or in other words, the peak to peak capacitor level voltage, delta VC, is the difference between the final capacitor voltage to the initial capacitor voltage. It would be 1 over C the integration, and 1 over C the integration, it can be represented as delta I multiplied by T over A, and this is divided by C. This means that the peak to peak capacitor level voltage delta VC would be delta I over 8C, and this T in the numerator, it can be replaced by 1 over F in the numerator. So delta VC is delta I over 8FC. By this way, we obtain the peak to peak rebel current in the inductor and the peak to peak rebel voltage at the capacitor. We already have proved that delta I it was VA multiplied the average voltage at the load multiplied by V source minus VA over FL multiplied by VS. So we can replace this delta I in the peak to peak rebel voltage at the capacitor by this quantity, and taking into consideration that VA over VS is K, and we can take VS here as a common factor, so it would be 1 minus VA over VS, so 1 minus K multiplied by VS. So we can prove that the peak to peak rebel voltage at the capacitor equals VS multiplied by the duty cycle K multiplied by 1 minus K over here this delta I. Here we have F and here we have F, so here F squared 8C, 8C, and here we have L, so 8LC F squared. So this is the final form for the rebel voltage, the peak to peak rebel voltage at the capacitor in terms of the input voltage source and the duty cycle and the inductance and capacitance and the operating frequency. Alright, the previous relation was actually related to delta I, so we still need what is delta I, but here this rule indicates the relation between the peak to peak regular voltage in terms of the original inputs of the buck regulator, which are the input voltage source, the duty cycle, the inductor, the capacitor, and the operating frequency or the show rate. Okay. Now, what will be the condition for continuous inductor current? As we said, the current at the inductor starts from I1, and when it is connected to the source, the current will increase in the charging period to I2. Then, at this charging period, the current at the inductor will flow through the load to the freewheeling diode, and it will decay from I2 to I1 once again, such that at the beginning of the next periodic cycle, it will be charging once again. The question now is, what is the maximum value of the inductance L such that this current is continuous? It doesn't reach to zero and stop completely, and then after a while, when it is connected to the source, it will start up from zero. So what is the condition such that the minimum current I1 will reach zero? And because if the value of L is greater than this value, the current will reach zero and still zero for a while. So the condition for continuous inductor current can be obtained by setting up the current I1 to be zero. So delta I here is effectively twice the average current IL, assuming that I'm going from zero to I2. So the average quantity would be I2 plus 0 over 2. This would be the average current across the inductor. So the current I1 would be 0, the minimum value, if delta I equals 2 times the average current at the inductor. So assuming that the average current at the conductor is I capital L, average current at the conductor, then the maximum delta I would be 2IL, the inductor repeater. And we have already proved that delta I is related to the voltage source and the duty cycle and the L and the frequency as delta I equals Vs multiplied by 1 minus K multiplied by K over F multiplied by L. So, by taking the limit that delta I equals 2IL and effectively the current across the load is actually the current across the inductor is the current across the load, the average current. So the average current at the load is the average current at the load. So 2IL is actually 2IA, where IA is the average current at the load, which should be constant. And IA is VA average, or the average voltage at the load over the resistance. And the average load is K multiplied by V source. So we can say that I average is K multiplied by V source over R, and we need 2 times I average, so 2K Vs over R. Now, by equating this term by this term, we can find that the critical value of the inductor, the maximum value of the inductor that can be used for the buck regulator, LC. LC would be the solution of L here. So LC, L, it would be R. This VS will be eliminated with VS. This K will be eliminated with this K. So R multiplied by 1 minus K over 2F. L would be 1 minus K multiplied by R over 2F. This is known as the critical value of the inductor. And we must use a value of inductor less than or equal to this LC. On the other hand, the condition for continuous voltage across the capacitor, condition for continuous capacitor voltage, this will introduce the critical value of the capacitor. And the critical value of the capacitor is actually what is the minimum value of the capacitor that can be used such that the voltage across the capacitor would be continuous. We are assuming the average voltage at the capacitor is VC, and actually VC is the average voltage at the load itself. So the average voltage at the capacitor is VC, and in this case the capacitor level voltage is delta VC, which is 2VA, assuming that the ripples, the maximum value of the ripples, if we have, this is the average voltage, the maximum is that we are going to positive VA above and negative VA minus. In this case, we have maximum 2V and minimum 0. If the ripple is more than 2V average, this means that the voltage at the capacitor will reach to 0 and continue to be 0 for a while, and this is not accepted. So the maximum ripple voltage, delta VC, is 2V average, where V average is the average voltage at 0. And already we have proved that delta VC equals VS, the source voltage, multiplied by 1 minus K multiplied by K over 8 LC F squared, which we have already proved. We have proved here delta VC VS K multiplied by 1 minus K over 8 LC F squared. So this delta VC, we are going to equate this delta VC with the maximum allowable delta VC. The maximum allowable delta VC is 2VA. And we know that VA is related to VS as VA equals KVS. So we can say that 2VA equals 2KVS. Now by equating this side with this side, we can eliminate VS with VS, K with K. So we can see C, the value of C, the minimum value of C, the critical value of C would equal 1 minus K, VS and K has been eliminated, over 16 L F squared. So the critical value of the capacitor, C critical, equals 1 minus K over 16 L multiplied by F squared. To obtain capacitor level voltage less than 2VA, the value of the capacitor must be greater than or equal to the critical capacitor value. So we have obtained two quantities, the critical inductor value and the critical capacitor value. And it should be noted here that the critical inductor vector inductor value, the critical inductor value, depends on the load resistance, the duty cycle, and the frequency. So it does not depend on the value of the capacitance. But the value of the critical capacitance depends on the inductance. So To solve for the critical capacitance, we must determine the value of L first, not the critical L, the value of L of the problem. And from the value of the L, we are going to obtain the critical value of the capacitance for this L. Okay? Assuming that we are using L critical, so this would be the critical capacitance for the critical inductance. But it shouldn't be the value of L is the critical L. It can be the solution of the problem. Alright? We will see in the next video a numerical example for this buck regulator. Finally, we have comments on buck regulator. The buck regulator requires only one transistor, is simple, and has high efficiency greater than 90%. The delta I over delta T of the load current is limited by the inductor L. However, the input current is discontinuous, and smoothing input filter is normally required. Buck regulator provides one polarity of the output voltage. So we usually have the positive is positive and the negative is negative. We cannot change between the polarity. And unidirectional output current. It requires a protection circuit in case of possible short circuit across the diode path. So assuming that the load is short circuit, we should have some protection circuit to avoid destructing the transistor switch. Alright.